It's half past eight. Half past eight.
It's half past eight, New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the experts. Each week at this time, Lucky Strike sets up a board of four know-it-alls for you to throw questions at. For every question we use, Lucky Strike pays out $10 plus a copy of the new Information Please quiz book. If your question stumps us, you get $25 more plus a 24-volume set of the current Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your questions to Information Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of duplication, Information Please uses the question that was received first, and all questions become the property of Information Please. And now light up a lucky strike as I present our master of ceremonies, the literary critic of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman. Mr. Fadiman.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me remind you again that Information Please is a completely unrehearsed and ad-lib performance from beginning to end. Now, tonight, we have with us that priceless pair, John Kieran, sports expert, naturalist, and classical authority, and Franklin P. Adams, light verse writer and conductor of the Conning Tower in the New York Post. Our guests are, first, the essayist, playwright, actor, and author of the bestseller Kitty Foyle, Christopher Morley, and the well-known athlete and coach of Notre Dame, recently appointed head of the Professional Football Commission, Mr. Elmer F. Layden. Now remember, for each question that's missed, Lucky Strike rings up $25. And that's paid out to the sender, plus 24 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Now, suppose we start our amiable festivities this evening with a question from Anne Fasella of Rosemont, Montreal, Quebec. This is a three-part question, gentlemen. We have to get two out of three to get by. Identify a sports figure and an historical figure, each of whom was known as the following. In the first case, they were both known as Prince Hal, a sports figure and an historical figure. Prince Hal, Mr. Kieran.
Prince Hal, of course, was the hero of, Henry IV and also Henry V. He was Henry V of England.
Yes, a long
in
run.
In Shakespeare's play.
That's right.
And Prince Hal in baseball was Hal Chase, first baseman of the Highlanders, beginning 1905.
That's, of course, way, way beyond my time. Would it also be Hal Schumacher?
Well, Prince Hal was the...
No.
Chase was the original Prince Hal. There were two, dozens more.
An original and one in the motion pictures. Wouldn't that be true of Mr. Schumacher?
Well, yes, you could say it in a nice way about him. He's a principal fellow and his name is Hal. But
they don't
the
call
Prince
him Prince Hal.
Hal of baseball was Hal Chase.
Good enough. All right. Now, how about the old fox, a sports figure and an historical figure, the old fox? You can split up on this if you wish, Mr. Adams.
The old fox was Griffith.
Yes. Can you give me a little more identification, Mr. Adams?
I think Marion.
No.
No, I think not.
The swamp fox.
The swamp fox, yes. So, Mr. Layden, what were you going to add?
That Griffith is... You wanted to know about the...
Yes. Will you tell us something about
Griffith
it?
Griffith is the owner of the Washington Baseball Club, the American
yes,
League.
Yes, that's correct. His first name being?
Clark.
Clark. We haven't got the old fox yet. Mr. Kieran.
I believe that George Washington was called the old fox by his British opponents, who complained that the old fox had slipped away from them again in the campaign in New Jersey.
That sounds all right to me, but I don't
there
think
was
that...
was
another
fox.
President it was.
It was another president, Mr. Adams, and who was it?
It might have been Zachary Taylor.
No, we can't. We don't have time
Jackson.
To go through all the presidents.
I give up.
Mr. Layden, were you? Did you have an idea?
William Henry Harrison.
No. Oh, that's... you've got everybody but Chester Arthur, Mr. Adams. It's Martin Van Buren, a great politician of his time who was known as the Old Fox. Though I think, Mr. Kieran, that you're right in a sense, but I don't think that epithet was generally given to Washington.
Van Buren was called Little Van.
Well, he might also have been called the Old Fox when he got larger.
Well,
I think we'll have to mark that half wrong. Now, how about this one, gentlemen? The peerless leader, a historical figure and a sports figure. The peerless leader, Mr. Morley.
Well, the historical figure, William Jennings Bryan.
Yes, certainly not a sports figure. And Mr. Adams?
Frank Leroy Chance.
Yes, can you give us his ascription?
He played first base for the Cubs.
And was he not formerly
and
manager?
And he was also manager.
Manager of the Chicago Cubs. Well, that gives us at least two out of three, two and a half out of three. Here's an off-the-record question, gentlemen, which we certainly ought to be able to answer. Sports figures and legendary figures, let's make this. The Four Horsemen sports figures. Mr. Layden, can you help us out on that?
The names of the Four Horsemen?
You mind?
Don Miller, who is now in Cleveland, an attorney.
How's he doing?
Well, he's doing very well. And Jimmy Crowley at Fordham University in New York, and Harry Stuhlder, athletic director and coach of the University of Wisconsin in Madison, Wisconsin.
Yes, that gives us three.
Yes.
Three out of four is generally enough, but in this case I'm going to ask four out of four. And fullback on the on that famous team, Mr. Layden?
Skyler Pick.
Oh, you're kidding us. Mr. Layden?
Elmer Layden.
He's too modest to mention that it was himself, of course, as everybody else knows. Now, who were the four horsemen in terms of old legend, or what would you call it, Mr. Kieran?
Well, it was famine, fire, and sword, and I've forgotten who the fourth was.
I don't think they were the four.
Well, they were, according to Ibanez.
They were?
Yes.
I'm not sure about this. I'm thinking out loud. Mr. Layden?
Wasn't it famine, pestilence, war?
Yes.
And
I think, was it greed? Was the fourth one greed?
No. Care.
Who?
Care.
Care?
So, care at the horseman's back.
Well, that would be a fifth. I'm not sure who the fourth was, but we'll know tomorrow when we get the answers from our listeners, I'm sure. Now, how about this one, gentlemen, from John G. Erickson, Jr. of Norfolk, Virginia. Get all on this. This is very easy. Give the well-known quotation that has come into common usage from each of these famous poems. Now, the first is the famous poem called To Helen by Edgar Allan Poe. From that, we get a very famous quotation that most of us know or should know. Mr. Kieran.
The glory that was Greece and the grandeur that was Rome.
Yes, very famous two lines. The glory that was Greece and the grandeur that was Rome. Now the next, a famous quotation that comes from John Greenleaf Whittier's poem, Maud Muller. We all learned this in school, I think. Some of us remember it. Mr. Kieran, for example. Mr. Adams?
For of all sad words of tongue or pen, the saddest are these it might have been.
That's exactly right, Mr. Adams. Thank you very much indeed. And there's a poem by Lowell called The Vision of Ceylon Fall, from which we get a couple of famous lines. Mr. Kieran, will you take that?
What is so rare as a day in June, then if ever come perfect days?
Can you go on with it, by the way?
Well, no.
Then heaven tries earth if it be in tune.
Very good, Mr. Adams. That's fine. And over it softly, her warm ear lips.
Her warm
I remember
ear
we had to memorize that in school.
Whether we look or whether we listen.
That's enough, Mr. Adams. That's enough. The next one from Leo Fraser of Absecon, New Jersey. It's about golf clubs. Get all on this. What golf club would you use, gentlemen, in the following circumstances? Mr. Adams, you don't play golf?
Don't play golf.
Mr. Adams is lying down for a few minutes there.
If they're in the road, I can maybe answer.
Now, suppose you had to drive about 125 yards over a hill without a roll. What golf club would you select? Mr. Layden?
125 yards over a hill without a roll. I'd say a six iron.
A six iron? Well, it's something like that. A five, six
iron, and
hope, Karen.
Yeah, you give a number. You can use any one of those short irons,
yeah.
But might be a good idea for Elmer to use a brassy.
Why? You've apparently played with Mr. Layden?
Yes.
How is Mr. Kieran, Mr. Layden, on the course?
Well, he apparently hasn't any faith in my strength.
That's the sort of people he likes to play with, Mr. Layden. Now, suppose you had to go a maximum distance from a spot off the fairway, but in short, smooth grass. Maximum distance off the fairway, but in short, smooth grass. What sort of golf club would you use? Mr. Layden again.
Brassy.
A brassy, I think. Now, suppose the ground was slightly rough. Would you select a different club?
I think a spoon.
A spoon, mid-iron, would you say? What would you say?
Well, you could use a number four wood, which is a very modified spoon. Mm-hmm. Or you can use a number two or three iron.
All right. Mr. Adams, are you going to take up golf?
No, sir.
Okay. At least that's settled. Now, suppose you... Suppose you had to get out of a sand trap. What would you use then? Sand trap. Mr. Morley, you don't play golf either.
Sorry.
Gee, this program is easy on you two boys.
We're just talking about the clubs. We don't get out.
Mr. Layden, you're going to answer
I'd say a sand wedge or a number nine iron.
I don't know these...
Niblick.
What's become a niblick?
That's a number nine.
We just got niblick in by the skin of its teeth, Mr. Adams.
Excuse me.
All right. How about this one, gentlemen? We don't seem to have stumped any of you yet. This comes from Charles H. Ryan of this city. What imaginary character calmed himself in moments of stress by doing these things? Get two out of three if you can. In the first case, he calmed himself by cracking his finger joints. He calmed himself by cracking his finger joints. Any ideas? Nasty habit. I hope none of you children
sounds
do
like,
it.
Sounds like Dickens?
Keep going, Mr. Kieran.
In Pickwick Papers?
No. You got the wrong novel. Pick another novel.
David Copperfield.
You bet. Now, give us the
Mr.
character.
Mr. Dick, was it? Or,
no.
Sorry. Have to count you wrong. It's Uriah Heep, you know, the nasty little fellow in David Copperfield who cracked his finger joints. Also, in Anna Karenina, Tolstoy's great novel, the husband of Anna, Alexei Karenina, cracks his finger joints, and it soothes him, says Tolstoy. Things to worry about. Now, in the second case, the character calmed himself by playing the violin. By playing the violin. Mr. Morley?
Sherlock Holmes.
Yes, from which we get the famous phrase, quick, Watson, the fetal. Isn't that true? How about flipping a coin? What character calmed himself by flipping a coin? This is not a character in a novel, but in a movie. Any ideas? Mr. Layden, did you ever have time when you were working with the team to attend movies? If not, you're excused.
Not very often. I thought maybe you might have meant the referee.
No, this is...
But not the captain.
In Scarface, a movie that most of us remember, George Raft. Playing a character in Scarface, is used to flip a coin from one hand to the other. Well, that gives us two wrong out of three, and courtesy of Lucky Strike sends $25 instead of the encyclopedia to Mr. Ryan. Thank you very much. Now, the next one comes from C.R. Holland of Altoona, Pennsylvania. Again, get two out of three. Gentlemen, this is a legal question. Explain these three legal terms. Malfeasance, misfeasance, nonfeasance. Now, I have the answers down here, but cannot understand any of the answers myself. I'll accept practically anything anybody says. Mr. Kieran?
Well, nonfeasance is easiest to knock off. That's not the crime of not doing something which you are legally bound to do.
That is correct.
Malfeasance is doing in the wrong way thing that you are supposed to do. That is misusing your powers, malfeasance in office.
You mean doing something wrongly which you are entitled to do rightly, would you say?
Yes.
And which one do you say that is?
That is malfeasance.
That's misfeasance.
That's right, Mr. Adams. How did you know, Mr. Adams?
I know
a lot
of lawyers.
It's got to be the other way.
That is a good definition.
More than you think.
Of misfeasance. Now, malfeasance would be, gentlemen, what? Any ideas?
Abuse of powers. It's abuse of powers, I believe.
Yes, the unjust performance of an act which a person had no right to do. I don't think that I can count that exactly right, Mr. Kieran, if you don't mind.
I appeal.
All right, maybe we can take it up to the Supreme Court sometime.
Exception.
Wait a minute. Now, we did get nonfeasance, and Mr. Adams gave us misfeasance, more or less.
I'd give the...
Give the man the books.
I give the man the books.
You want to give the man the books?
Yes, and a set of law books.
All right, Mr. Holland. We'll send you a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica and $25, courtesy of Lucky Strike. Now let's see what we can do with this one from Mrs. Sidney Knight of Carthage, Missouri. Give four quotations, gentlemen, from prose or poetry, which mention dogs. Mr. Adams, you can use your doggerel if you wish on this. Mr. Kieran?
I'd rather be a dog and bay the moon than such a Roman.
That's a peach. From what is that, Mr.?
That is from Julius Caesar.
Yes, who says the words?
I believe that was Cassius.
I think it's Brutus, but I may be wrong.
I think it's Cassius trying to persuade Brutus to join the conspiracy.
I think it's Brutus because I'm trying to persuade myself that it's Brutus, Mr. Kieran. That, however, is a perfectly correct quotation, whether it was Brutus or Cassius who said it. Now, another quotation using the word dog. Mr. Morley.
O. Henry's favorite. I had a little dog, and his name was Rover, and when he died all over.
Hey, that's very cute. Is that O. Henry? Thank you, Mr. Morley. That gives us two dogs out of four. Mr. Kieran?
Well, it's one of Kipling's in which the dog Herates fly, and... That's part of a long poem, but it's really in there.
You want to give us the whole poem?
No, I don't want to give it.
I'll accept it, if you assure me on your word of honor.
Well, there's another one. I'll give you another one right from Kipling. To this dead dog for my father's sake, in Rimmon's house I bow.
I'm sure that's right. Why I know it, I don't know.
And there's
I'm sure
one,
that's right. Mr. Adams?
A poem that begins When Sirius Shines.
Oh, the dog's dog.
The dog's dog.
Oh, that's very classical. A little far-fetched, but very good. How about a Mother Goose rhyme about the little dog who laughed to see such sport and the dish ran away with a spoon? Or another one from your favorite author, Mr. Kieran?
Old Mother Hubbard.
That's Mr. Adams' favorite author. I was thinking if I am Sir Oracle and when I open my lips, let no dog bark. That gives us four out of four. Now, so far, Lucky Strike has paid out $50 and two sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. And now Mr. Cross brings us some bulletins from the tobacco front.
Yes, Mr. Fadiman. I have here reports from many tobacco markets. These reports show just what really happens in the lively competition for finer, lighter, milder tobacco at the auctions. For example, in Lebanon, Kentucky, during the past season, the American Tobacco Company paid 34% more per pound for the tobacco it bought for its cigarettes and other tobacco products. Yes, 34% above the average market price paid for all the various types and grades of tobacco sold there. And the best we bought will go to Lucky's. And so it goes at market after market. At Greenville, Tennessee, American, on the same basis, paid 40% more. Boone, North Carolina, American paid 42% more. Yes, Lucky Strike consistently pays higher prices and gets the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder leaf. Isn't that just the kind of tobacco you want to enjoy in your cigarette? Next time, ask for Lucky Strike.
Brief and to the point, Mr. Cross. I timed you at exactly 60 seconds. Now, suppose we go on, the second half of the program, with a question from Steve Petrovich of Ypsilanti, Michigan. Now, this is a football question. The winning streaks of three major colleges, gentlemen, were broken in 1940. Can you give me the names of the colleges and the names of the 11s that stopped their winning streaks? Mr. Layden?
Tennessee.
How big was the winning streak? How many games and who stopped them?
I think 2 years. They had...
I mean, was it an uninterrupted string of victories?
No, I beg your pardon. We lost to Southern California in the Rose Bowl the previous year.
There would have to be an uninterrupted string broken finally in 1940. Mr. Kieran.
Georgetown.
Georgetown. Yes, that was a string of how many victories, do you remember?
Well, it ran over two seasons. It ran well beyond two seasons, I think. I don't remember the
exact... Mr. Layden?
22 games.
22 exactly, Mr. Layden. That's right. Thank you. Mr. Adams also had it. And Georgetown fell before whom?
Boston College.
Boston College, as Mr. Layden, Mr. Kieran, and Mr. Adams said at once. Now, how about another one? What other winning streak can you think of in 1940 that was broken by whom? Mr. Layden?
Seems to me that Nebraska was undefeated for 2 years, and it was broken by Stanford in the Rose Bowl.
I wouldn't know. I'll have to appeal to Mr. Kieran on that. Would that be right, Mr. Kieran?
I'd have to check back when they're in 39
Minnesota
season.
Minnesota play Nebraska?
I beg your pardon. That's right, too. If we get this threshed out.
The thing for you to do, Mr. Layden, is never to appear on the same program with Mr. Kieran. But it's a tough one to answer. Well, there was Cornell. Cornell won 17 games in a row before she bowed to Dartmouth. I think there was one tie there in among them.
Photo finish.
very good. And finally, Texas Aggies had a record of 19 successive triumphs before they lost to Texas 7-0. Well, it's pretty tough remembering those. Tough enough anyway to send $25, courtesy of Lucky Strike, to Mr. Petrovich, plus a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. And that question will send us on to the next one from Mrs. D.M. Houston of Mesa, Arizona. You can relax on this, gentlemen. It's much easier than the last one. Give the climax of these Mother Goose rhymes. I shall read you the initial part of the story, and you give me the climax. One, little Polly Flinders sat among the cinders, warming her pretty little toes. Her mother came and caught her and whipped her little daughter. What happened finally, gentlemen?
For spoiling her nice new clothes.
For spoiling her nice new clothes, yes. Mr. Adams, you are the proud possessor of four children, and I believe.
Yes, sir.
And therefore deserve practically no credit for knowing the answer. Mr. Layden, how many children do you have?
Four.
You see how much a better father Mr. Adams is.
Split that credit.
Now, here's another. There was an old woman, as I've heard tell. She went to market, her eggs for to sell. She went to market all on a market day. And the climax of that story, gentlemen? No idea. You could almost make up a...
Read those at home, too.
She fell asleep on the King's Highway, is the way that ends. That gives us one wrong. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickles. Well, there I go. I knew that would happen. I'll start all over again. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. A peck of pickled peppers Peter Piper picked. If Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, gentlemen, how does it go on?
How many pecks of peppers did Peter Piper pick?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Very good, Mr. Adams. You left out the adjective before peppers. How many pecks of...
Pickled peppers.
Don't be... we don't want a little indelicacy.
How
many pecks
peppers.
Of pickled peppers did Peter Piper pick? That gives us 2 out of 3, which is all we were required to get, and sends us on to this question. Also a 2 out of 3 question. This is from Ernest C. Simmons of San Francisco, California. It's about card games, gentlemen. What game is being played when the players are dealt two cards each and may draw more cards if they wish? What game?
And may draw more.
And may draw more if they wish. They're dealt two cards apiece. Mr. Kieran?
Stud poker.
Stud poker?
Oh.
Oh, no.
Oh, oh, what are you doing tonight?
Oh, oh, wait a minute.
Oh, he's dealt
two. Well, you have to pay for more, don't you?
No, but they are not dealt two cards each.
One face, one down, and one up.
I know, but in the game of stud poker, the entire deal would be a matter of five cards, unless you play seven cards each.
Well, I know, but you stop. If you don't pay, you don't get any more than two cards.
What would you say, Mr. Adams, to that?
That's true.
So,
look here, Mr.
Would that be gin rum?
No, I think it would be, unless that's the same as blackjack, is it? Or 21.
Blackjack.
No, it isn't.
In the game of 21, you get two cards, and you may draw another if you wish to make up the sum.
I'm off, too. Gin rum has 10 cards.
I'll come to that, Mr. Layden. How about this case? The players use a complete deck of cards each without the joker. Mr. Kieran.
Russian Bank.
Russian Bank, yes. Any other names for it?
Not in the Bronx.
I think another name for it is crapette. I'm not sure about that. Is it the same as double solitaire or double patience? Well, in the case of double solitaire, you do use a complete deck of cards,
too. Well, that isn't double solitaire because in Russian Bank, you play, mix the cards up.
That's correct. How about the case in which the players are dealt 12 cards each, and the next card is turned up? Mr. Kieran.
Pinochle.
Pinochle, two-handed pinochle.
I still think stud poker is all right, too.
I know you still think so. And maybe you're right. At any rate, we got two out of three, which gives us a perfectly safe pass and sends us on to this one. Another two out of three question from Mrs. Ralph H. Sanborn of Raymond, New Hampshire. Mr. Layden, you ought to know something about lines in accordance with your experience. Can you identify the following lines? The first is thin red line. Thin red line. Mr. Morley.
It's a quotation from Kipling.
It is indeed.
The thin red line of Eros.
Yes. Can you give us the whole thing, Mr. Morley? Oh, two or three lines.
Well, the idea of it is that Tommy Atkins doesn't amount to much when he's at home, but it's the thin red line of Eros when the band begins to play.
That's right, except it's when the drums begin to roll, but it's the same idea. It's Tommy this and Tommy that and Tommy ours your soul, but it's thin red line of Eros when the drums begin to roll.
And in one of the other verses is when the bands begin to play.
You're just like Mr. Kieran tonight, Mr. Morley. Matter of fact, that is right. I'm sure there is a line in which the bands enter. Now, how about this? Line of black. This is the second of these lines. Line of black. I think this is very difficult, gentlemen. Line of black. It's from a poem. It's from a well-known poem, Mr. Morley.
I think it's still Vachel Lindsay's The Congo.
Can you give me the line?
Cutting through the darkness with a golden track.
Yes, but it isn't a line of black, I don't think.
Well, the river, like a line of black cutting through the darkness with a golden track.
I'm going to give you $25 and half a set of the encyclopedia if you're right, Mr. Morley. I'm not sure. I don't have the book with me. There is a line from Longfellow's Ride of Paul Revere. For suddenly all his thoughts are bent on a shadowy something far away, where the river widens to meet the bay, a line of black that bends and floats on the rising tide like a bridge of boats. It's not a very well-known quotation. Probably even Mr. Kieran doesn't know it. Do you, Mr. Kieran?
No, I do not.
That's right. Have to count that wrong, and if you're right, we'll adjudicate it afterward, Mr. Morley. Now, how about half a line? Half a line. Mr. Kieran?
Nor all your piety, nor all your wit can call it back to...
Cancel
half a line. Nor all your tears wash out a word of it.
Yes, that's very good. Wash out a word of it. From whom?
That is also from Omar Khayyam, Fitzgerald's translation.
That's a peach. Well, that gives us at least two out of three. Thank you very much. Now, what can you do with this one, gentlemen? From Bessie Crane of East Orange, New Jersey. What character in literature was called each of these terms of endearment and by whom? Get two out of three. The first term of endearment is dearest. Who called whom dearest? Mr. Adams.
Little Lord Fauntleroy's mother.
Called whom, dearest?
Cedric Errol.
I think you've got everything right, except it wasn't the other way around. Mr. Morley?
Oh, he called his mother that.
That's right. Remember that, Mr. Morley? Why did he call her that? Mr. Morley?
Well, it was a form of megalomania.
Oh, that's an awfully long word. We only have a minute and a half, Mr. Well, wasn't it because his papa, as I imagine they would say it in that book, had always called his mother that, and so the little boy had learned to say it, too, to imitate her, as it were. He called her Dearest. Now, if you've got the taste of that out of your mouth, gentlemen, we'll go on to the next part of this question. Dodie. Who called whom Dodie? This is much better. Dodie, gentlemen. Mr. Kieran?
Not Dodo.
No. Dodie. Dora nicknamed her husband David Copperfield that, in the book of the same name by Mr. C. Dickens.
That broke up their home.
It would be enough to do so. Dodie. Now, the third is Dalink. Dalink? Who called whom Dalink? Mr. Morley?
Well, I should think it's Thunder Over the Bronx.
It's in the same line, but I don't think you'll find Dalink in Mr. Kober's book. No, you'll find it in a book by Milt Gross called Nye's Baby. Nye's Baby eat up all the spinach, darling.
That's a song. That will send... Dalek, I am growing old.
That will send $25 instead of the encyclopedia to Mr. S.E. Crane. And now here's Mr. Cross with a gentleman we all know, Mr. Speed Riggs, the tobacco auctioneer.
Mr. Riggs is going to tell us just what happens at a tobacco auction when a basket of the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder tobacco comes up for sale.
Well, Mr. Cross, if it's really fine, mild leaf, all the tobacco buyers perk up right away. They start firing one bid after another at me.
So it develops into a regular battle royal of bids.
And that's a good name for it, Mr. Cross. They'll bid up a basket of tobacco like that so it sells for $10 or $15 more per 100 pounds than other baskets right at the same auction.
Thank you, Mr. Riggs. And smokers, remember this. The independent experts at every tobacco auction see who pays the price to get that finer, lighter, milder leaf. They see and they smoke Luckies by a vast majority. Yes, remember, with independent experts, auctioneers, buyers, and warehouse men, with men who know tobacco best, it's Luckies 2-1.
Thank you, Mr. Cross and Mr. Riggs. Now, tonight, Lucky Strike has sent out a total of $100 and 4 sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Lucky Strike thanks you, Mr. Layden and Mr. Morley, for coming tonight. Next week, Mr. Adams, Mr. Levant, and Mr. Kieran will be on deck as usual. And as our fourth expert, we are privileged to announce the Secretary of Agriculture of the United States, Mr. Claude Wickard. Now remember, for every question we use, whether or not it's answered correctly, the sender gets $10. If the question stumps our experts, you not only get $25 more, but in addition, the complete 24-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your letters with questions and the correct answers to Information, Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now a parting message from Mr. L.A. Speed Riggs, famous tobacco auctioneer of Goldsboro, North Carolina.
And that chant, fully interpreted, ladies and gentlemen, means Luckies pay higher prices for the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder tobaccos. With independent tobacco experts, auctioneers, buyers, warehouse men, with men who know tobacco best, it's Luckies 2-1.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.